Hello, everyone. I want to thank you for being here on behalf of Anita B at our featured session. Our mission is to connect, inspire, and guide women in computing and organizations that view technology and innovation as a strategic imperative. We envision a future where the people who imagine and build technology mirror the people and the organizations for whom they are building it. We are so excited to have Sarah EchoHawk, CEO of the American Indian Science and Engineering Society here at GHC 2017. Sarah EchoHawk, an enrolled member of the Pawnee Nation of Oklahoma, has been the Chief Executive Officer of the American Indian Science and Engineering Society since May of 2013. A national American Indian nonprofit organization founded in 1977, AISES' mission is to substantially increase the representation of American Indians, Alaskan Natives, and Native Hawaiians, Pacific Islanders, First Nations, and other indigenous people of North America in science, technology, engineering, and math, studies, and careers. Let's give a big round of applause and warm welcome to Sarah EchoHawk.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Wow, I got a big crowd. But thank you for coming. Again, my name is Sarah EchoHawk. Nawa, hello. And before I get started, I wanted to show a brief video. They'll roll that.
This is our flag. We have our national and our state and our tribal flags, but this is our flag. This is AISES's flag. This is who we are as a nation.
It kind of cleanses our energy. It's waking up us up to the sacredness of this moment.
It truly goes back to the one single word that I believe that this room and this organization emulates is family.
I met some of my very, very best friends at Leadership Summit, and I want that to happen for you.
It's really an opportunity to meet with people across the United States with similar interests, as well as some of the similar cultural backgrounds, which I haven't had an opportunity to explore.
I feel that this one's more intimate. You get to take a little bit more time, talk with the people. At Nationals, there's so many people, and still get the same message, but just making a stronger connection with people.
The hotel is great. Love the hotel. Here, look at the sunny. It's very sunny outside. Cacti, I don't know.
You're all here at a leadership conference because of either your existing leadership or where we hope to be as a student.
It's incredibly important for our students to know where they're speaking from, who they are, what their cultural values are.
Group harmony is really important for the fellows because they are a group and they have to do a group project and they have to work together in order to make that successful.
I've been to the AISES National Conference, region conferences, but this is my first leadership summit. I love it. I've been able to network with other professionals, talk to other faculty members into how to start that pathway into a faculty position.
Throughout the Leadership Summit, you'll be looking for the students who show the potential to be a leader and who you think is already a leader.
Just this last session, that was a big major theme. And I just try to tell everyone, because I'm going through that myself, be more outgoing, be yourself.
It was nice to like have a support system to like teach me how to get jobs, teach me how to introduce myself and how to step up as like a leader.
Communication skills, respect, integrity, vision, goals. The person to receive this award is Kayla Johnson.
I didn't expect this. Thank you.
The camaraderie. That feeling that you're feeling right now is the feeling that I think keeps the professionals coming back to AISES. It's that feeling of family. We refer to ourselves as the AISES family.
And that's my family there. I love my AISES chapter.
I never knew nerddom could be beautiful.
Uh-oh, how do I use this? Okay. So can I get the, there we go. All right, so That's a little bit about AISES. That was our leadership summit, which is a smaller version of the national conference. There's about 230 participants at the leadership summit every year, and that's mostly about student and professional leadership development. And then we have a larger conference that was actually just 2 weeks ago, for those who aren't familiar, that's about 2,000 people. So what I was saying was, we've been, as mentioned, we were founded in 1977, so we just had our 40th anniversary, which we were really proud of. And just last year, we expanded our definition of in American Indians, so we wanted to include Alaska Natives, Native Hawaiians, Pacific Islanders, First Nations, which are Canadian Indigenous peoples, and then other Indigenous peoples of North America. So we are about STEM, but certainly computing is a large part of that. So what I wanted to talk about today, and then have a dialogue, certainly if there are questions, is about the, this is going to sound like a lot, about the historical and political development of Native nations in the United States. Because what we so often face when I go to conferences and I meet people is that there's a lot of misunderstanding and stereotypes about Native people, and often we're viewed through the lens of race. That's the conversation that we have in this country a lot, is about race. And certainly we're part of that conversation, but more so, we are also Native nations. We have dual citizenship. Native people are citizens of the United States and citizens of their tribe. And so we look at the way we view ourselves as a nation, and we look through that lens. So race is secondary to our citizenship and our membership in a tribe. And so with this, they keep putting my slide up, taking it away. Can I have my slide back? Did it go away? There it is. Okay, so why I wanted to have this up here is on the far left over here, we see this beautiful Native woman in her traditional regalia. It's not a costume, it's called regalia, right? And that's often how people picture us. And certainly that is a large part of what we do. I mean, even in the video you saw, there's culture, right? And we embrace that and we integrate that into everything that we do. But moreover, we're also contemporary people. So this is our magazine, Winds of Change, and you can see this beautiful woman here who's an engineer. And in between is kind of the mixing of those, right? This woman is getting her hair braided, her poster presentation, I think this was after the poster presentations were down, right? But we meld those two together, and we do it very well. So what I wanted to talk about today is, again, this kind of historical development, but to help you understand where Natives are today, because I know this because for 9 years I was an adjunct professor of Native American Studies, and students would come into my class, and what they received in their K-12 education in terms of Native American history, it was completely inaccurate. And so a lot of people don't understand who we are as a people. So these are the topics I'm going to talk through today, and hopefully quickly so I don't run out of time. So quick true or false, all Native Americans today are rich from casinos and gaming. Yeah, that's totally false. But we get that all the time. I work for a nonprofit, and we asked for contributions, and we got this one back that was like, I'm not gonna contribute, I gave at the casino or something. It was funny. But there's this perception that we're all very wealthy, and that is a very small, small group that actually has that kind of wealth. A lot of tribes, like my tribe, is in a remote rural area. If we built a casino, the only people that would go there would be members of the tribe. So those are rare exceptions. And then there's this perception then, why don't Indian, Native American, Indigenous, Native, interchangeably, that one tribe that's doing well should share their wealth with other tribes. But as you'll learn as we go through, these are individual, independent nations. And that's like asking Colorado to share revenue with Arizona, right? Or Germany to share its revenue with, I don't know, France. It doesn't work that way, right? All right. So Native Americans don't pay taxes. False. we pay federal and state taxes. The only time that Natives don't pay taxes is on revenue that's earned from trust resources on Indian reservations. And that would be I don't want to get into a lot of detail, but that would be like timber harvesting or other natural resources that might be harvested by the tribe, the tribal government. They would not pay taxes on that. Individuals pay taxes. The only way you wouldn't pay state taxes ever is if you live and work on the reservation. But I live in Longmont, Colorado. I pay federal and state taxes. Native Americans get to go to college for free. That is completely false. There are some tribes that are wealthier, and certainly they have scholarship programs, and if you're lucky enough, I don't have one of those tribes, we're not wealthy, you can apply for scholarships. But it's not something, the federal government doesn't pay for us to go to college. Native Americans all live on reservations. The majority of Native Americans live off the reservation. And again, this idea that we're in the past, there are these Native stereotypes and why Native people get so offended by these Native American mascots and stereotypes, because we are contemporary people. I'm not standing up here in my riding my horse with my teepee, right? All right, so a few quick facts. We are sovereign nations. We're about 567 tribes. That's in the lower 48 and Alaska. About 229, I think, are in Alaska, and then the rest would be in the lower 48. As sovereign nations, we have the right to determine our citizens, have tribal law, and in the Constitution, basically it's recognized that tribes are separate from state and federal, that they're independent nations, and tribes actually have a status higher than states. So with exception and getting into the legalese, state law does not apply on Indian land. We make our own laws. Federal law, but we'll talk about that later. Okay, talked about number. What do you call Native Americans? I mentioned that. Native American, American Indian, Indian, Indigenous, Native. It depends on who you ask and who you're talking to. We're about 2% of the total population, which is why we often get overlooked and left out. So all these discussions around diversity and inclusion, usually it's like African-American, Latino, Asian, and then it might be other. But a lot of times we're just completely left out. We don't even get mentioned. Who is Native American? There's this idea of blood quantum. My grandfather was quote unquote full-blooded, my dad was half, so I'm a quarter. We're the only group, ethnic group of people that have to do that, right? Who else has to do that? And we get asked that question a lot, too. How much Indian are you? I'm like, I don't know, I'm Native. All right, so that's something, and some tribes require blood quantum, but that was something really that was instituted by the federal government. It's not something that was put in place by tribes. Finally, there's this issue of federal recognition. So I said there's 567 tribes, roughly. Those are federally recognized tribes, meaning the United States government says, yeah, we recognize you as an Indian tribal nation. But there are also a lot of tribes out there that may only have state recognition or may have no recognition outside of themselves. And those are also Native people. So a little bit about worldview in terms of how Indigenous people, this is huge generalization, so this isn't, I'm gonna make some very broad generalizations here. But just to kind of understand how Indigenous people here think of themselves and how that runs counter often to U.S. mainstream society and our ideas around individualism particularly. So we have this concept of the circle, and you'll see this in a lot of things that have to do with Indigenous peoples, where we say the creator, God, whatever you want to call it, is really at the center. But the creator we see is in everything. So if you look at the outer circle here, people, rocks, plants, water, animals, whatever, everything is connected, and everything is connected to the creator. And so it's not linear at all, it's a circle. And if you think about, for instance, and I'm not making any judgments, I'm just trying to put this for comparison, Christianity, right? You have God and then the apostles and the Pope, and it's like a hierarchy, right? And here in Indigenous worldview, it's a circle. And remember, these two cultures come together, right? It doesn't always work out. So this was pre-contact, and these are not even all of the tribes, but this was the original layout, and then you can see it spreads across. And I'm actually gonna show you this slide. So in 1492, obviously Indian land was all of it. And this doesn't even include Alaska or Hawaii or Mexico, Central South America, right? But you can see this westward expansion that goes across and where we are today in terms of Indian land holding. So at that time, when Europeans made contact with native nations, there was that clashing of worldviews. In 1492, what was happening? Let's think about what was happening in Spain. Somebody know? Shout it out. The Inquisition, right? And the Reconquest, right? And the expulsion of Muslims and Jewish people, right? To Christianize, the Crusades, okay? So all of this is kind of the context in which these cultures came together. And so there was definitely a clashing of cultures at that point when Europeans made contact here. But the one thing that I want to note that is interesting is that when Europeans did arrive, they made treaties, right? We always hear about Indian treaties, okay? And then, by the way, in the Constitution, it says treaties are the supreme law of the land. And it doesn't say except Indian treaties. It says treaties. And a lot of those have been broken, as we know. But that's an acknowledgement of sovereignty, of governance, of self-determination. You don't make treaties between individuals. Those are made between nations. And so European nations acknowledged, at least, the nationhood status of natives. And I didn't say gave, right? Because native nations have been sovereign since time immemorial. So rather, it was just acknowledged. The doctrine of discovery is today the foundation of U.S. tribal relations. And again, without getting into a lot of detail, that came out of something called several of the papal bulls, which were issued by the Catholic Church at the time. But this idea that native peoples were, Europeans were superior to native people, and that the first nation to claim land in the New World, it wasn't really new, we'd been here forever, but in the New World to lay that claim had first right to that land. And that basically replaced what we call Aboriginal title. I'll talk about that later. But that concept is still true today and is what is the foundation of federal Indian law today and how we are treated. One last thing about reservations. I always hear people say, oh yeah, well, when they gave the so-and-so tribe that reservation, I'm like, they gave them a reservation, the US government. That's false. Remember, Indians had the whole land base and it shrank. And reserve is a legal term. So states have reserved rights, meaning that whatever rights the federal government doesn't explicitly say that it has is left to the states. So in other words, Indians had all this land and then they reserved portions of that land. Okay, that's very different than the US saying this is all our land and now we give you this, right? It's reserved. Okay, so then we get into the US period. A lot of what happened during this time was that westward expansion, this idea of manifest destiny, the United States to spread across the continent, bring Christianity and individualism. Individual land ownership is very central to, it's an American value, right? The American dream, what is it? To own a home, right, as an individual. That's contrary to the way Native people see things. And then we had something called the Marshall cases that came up through the Supreme Court, and Justice Marshall basically, through these cases, adopted that doctrine of discovery as US law. This is when it came. And it basically says that, again, if a European nation claims law, like let's say England, right, the 13 colonies originally were England, they claim that land, and they basically get to have that superior title to native people because they said so. That's it. They said, this is ours, and now we own it because of the doctrine of discovery, because we are superior. That's it. So then the US went to war against Great Britain. The US won the war, and that title of discovery that Britain had transferred to the US. And that's how the US got title to Indian land. That's it. Domestic dependent nations. So Marshall did find, or the Supreme Court did find, that while there's this Aboriginal title that Indians are subservient, if you will, in terms of land title to European nations, the United States, they are still nations. So if you break that down, domestic dependent nations, domestic meaning within the US, right? Not foreign, domestic, dependent. Dependent on who? The US government, nations. So there's this federal dependency that's established, right? That the United States is responsible for these dependent nations. So you're a nation, but you're a nation within a nation. And so it comes up with this kind of ward-guardian relationship is what they call it, which is really kind of like a parent-child relationship. And the United States really takes this stance that they know what's best for Indians. And that's what we're gonna see, you know, that plays out throughout history. I already talked about law. Okay, so then we move into the 1800s, mid-1800s, early 1900s, and assimilation really became the policy. In other words, in order to save this vanishing race and save these uncivilized people, kill the Indian, meaning take culture, take that away, re-educate them, Christianize them, make them into a mold of what we think as US citizens that these people should look like. And so we had an allotment act. Indians lost about 90 million more acres at that point, where they took tribal land and they broke it into individual land allotments and assigned it to individuals or families and expected them then to live as individuals and not communally. And then the surplus land was often homesteaded or sold. Okay, so again, you're gonna be an individual, this is gonna be your land. And that was part of, if you think about some of the founding principles of the United States, right? People wanted to come here, and the idea that not just people with high status could own land, anybody could own land, right? And so that was kind of seen like, this is gonna be good for Indians. They're gonna learn to be industrious and individuals, right? But that completely starts to break up that tribal structure. I should say boarding schools. So they also took kids, Indian kids, from their families and sent them to boarding schools. This went on for a long time. They cut their hair, they made them not, they couldn't speak their language, they Christianized them, they dressed them in, you know, US, you know, kind of mainstream clothing, and really, again, gave them English names. They had to, they couldn't use their native names anymore. And again, the idea was, let's assimilate them. What would happen, though, when they go back to the reservation, it's just, you know, the society is crumbling at that point because you have these two competing views. And there's racism. You know, as a full-blooded Native person in 1900, you go through boarding school, then you're gonna go try to get a job. Who's gonna give you a job? You're an Indian. So the other thing that happened during this time is the Congress, is it Congress or the Supreme Court? Anyway, the federal government ended treaty making with Native nations. They said, okay, we're not gonna change any of existing treaties, but we're not gonna make any new treaties. In other words, kind of chipping away at that sovereignty again, right? And then further, we see the Supreme Court ruling on a case that basically says, okay, well now we're gonna end treaty making, and now Congress can change treaties at any time, because Congress is the guardian of Indian nations and therefore has that ability to do it. And Congress knows what's best. So Congress has the ability to do that as long as it's acting in the best interest of Indians. But who determines if it's in the best interest? Congress, okay? And then finally, Indians are made citizens of the United States in 1924. And that's where the dual citizenship comes in. Okay, so then we get, I just put in pictures in here of contemporary natives throughout this. So then from the 1930s to 1960s, what happens is, right, the United States goes through a depression. And so in the late 1920s, there's a report that comes out called the Merriam Report that says, all of these federal policies of assimilation have failed. Indians are worse off than ever. They're impoverished, they're starving to death. Education is substandard, health is substandard. And so they come up with the Indian Reorganization Act in 1934. And like the New Deal for America, right, to rebuild America after the Depression, Indians get a New Deal. And what's really interesting is this is when we get a lot of bankruptcy laws. And if you read this act, basically what it did is it restructured tribal governments, traditional tribal governments, to look like corporations, right? So Indians were bankrupt, so now they're gonna reform. And if they reform under these corporate structures, chairman, vice chairman, secretary, whatever, treasurer, elected council, and just really quick, a lot of people think tribal councils are very traditional. Well, often this is what they are. Okay, so then they say, if you do this, then you have access to all of these programs and this funding. So it was really a way to kind of the carrot to get Indians to do this, but just really further assimilation at that point. And what that does is that sets up a conflict between traditional government and tribal government. I'm sorry, traditional government and these IRA reorganization governments. And we still see a lot of issues today. It did end allotment, which was good, after 90 million acres were lost in like a 40-year period, and began closing boarding schools. So this goes on, and then we turn around just very quickly in 1950, and we go through a policy called termination, where the government's like, we're gonna get out of the Indian business altogether, meaning we're just gonna terminate tribes. In other words, no longer are you a sovereign nation. You know, we're gonna pay you $1,500 a person in your tribe, and you're gonna wake up tomorrow morning, and your land is private, and you're no longer an Indian. That's it. And it was sold as emancipation, right? This idea, if you think about in the 1950s of the Civil Rights Movement, what were African Americans asking for? Integration, right? We wanna be like everybody else, we wanna have the same rights as everybody else, we wanna have the same access, no more segregation. Right, so we think of that again in the context of race, that makes sense. But for Native people, we don't want to be integrated in that sense. We want to maintain our sovereignty and our traditions and our culture. And we want to continue to be nations. And so this was also devastating. Okay, so then get up to where the 1960s to today. And the Civil Rights Movement did help spur this, Native people seeing this activism, because really that started with non-institutional methods, the civil rights movement, right? Protests and takeovers and things that are non-institutional, because if you don't have a lot of means, that's what you're gonna do to push change. It's not like you have representation in government, right? So what do? You have to use what you have. And so Native people see that and they're like, yeah, we need to do that. And part of what happened that facilitated that was relocation. It's another assimilation policy that backfired, though, on the United States government. It said, let's take Indians off of the reservation and move them to cities, and they can get jobs. Okay, of course, they didn't get very good jobs, but what they did was they brought all of these Indians that were living in different tribal communities, different areas, and brought them together, and they all started to talk in the middle of the Civil Rights Movement and say, yeah, things are really bad for us too. Oh, for you too? Yeah, okay. So they inadvertently kind of brought this political movement, this political resurgence on them. So we got the American Indian Movement, or AIM, came out of Minneapolis in, I think, 1967, 68, which is a social movement of American Indians to demand, again, protesting. And there was Alcatraz Island, if anybody's heard of that, or Wounded Knee, or these other demonstrations, right, to say we want to be recognized again as sovereign nations. Also out of that was the War on Poverty. So there were programs, not just for Indians, and I think maybe this is where the myth about free education comes from, but for underrepresented groups, poor and other oppressed groups, the government created the War on Poverty, and there were opportunities for education and job training, and of course Indians participated in that. And so we have the emergence of Native attorneys for the first time. Well, we had some before, but this was like when we got this big upswing. And once we started getting attorneys that were Native, and they went back and they started reading all of this, they realized that Indians actually have substantial rights, and that they just haven't been enforced. Because if you don't have a lawyer to enforce them, you're not gonna get anywhere. So that really helped them, and they used that to overturn termination and to fight termination. And so those tribes that were terminated were eventually restored. So a lot of tribes will have restoration celebrations of when their tribal status was restored. Of course, a lot of damage had been done at that point, but at least they got back their government and their land, some of their land holding. And the federal government then adopts this new Indian policy of self-determination, meaning we need, as the United States, yes, we're the guardian, if you will, of tribes, but we need to let tribes decide for themselves what is in their best interest, and we need to support them in that. And one thing I will also, I forgot to note, I mentioned the trust, that word trust. The federal government is also said to be the trustee for Indian nations. So if you were lucky enough to have a trust account, right, there's somebody who administers that and watches out for it and supposed to take care of it for you. It's the same idea. The United States government is supposed to be our trustee and it's supposed to watch out for us. And if you think about all of the land that was ceded to the United States and what's left, that's the basis for the trust relationship. This is really simplifying it, but basically, Indians gave up land in exchange for education and other support services. The federal government said, in exchange for the land, we will provide you education, we will provide you these programs. So people always think, oh, Indians get all this stuff for free. I'm like, first of all, that's not true. But what we do get is because it's the law, and it is what the US federal government said it would do, and it set it up, we didn't. And so when that stuff does happen, that's why. That's why Indians do get some of those benefits, because it was in exchange for the loss of all of our land. All right. So, get off that topic. I just want to talk a little bit, since we are at Anita B, about Native American women. And again, these are big generalizations. But generally, traditionally, Native women had tremendous power in their societies and a lot of influence. They were healers, medicine women, builders, advisors, landholders often, like not in the sense that we think, but when they would communally farm land, the women, it was through the women would have the different plots. And a lot of Native societies are matrilineal, meaning it's not through your dad, it's through your mom. And so, like my tribe was traditionally that way. So if you got married, you went and lived with your wife's family. So it was all through the woman. And a lot of that changed through colonialism. And so again, with this assimilation policy and colonialism, a lot of that shifted. And so women were really disenfranchised. And today, I didn't add this, but Native women have the highest rate of domestic violence of any group in the United States. And the most common offenders are non-Indians against Indian women, Native women. So we're starting to see a resurgence, and certainly like Crystal here, who's amazing, on the cover here, are reclaiming and coming back into power in our communities and starting to heal all of that. In fact, nearly a quarter of our tribal nations today are led by women. So we're starting back on that path. And I just wanted, again, to add that we're contemporary, right? But also the keepers of tradition and culture as well. Native Americans as scientists, engineers, and mathematicians. Often, you know, when I deal with these stereotypes, people think, you know, these traditional Native people, like, how does that work with computing or engineering? Like, that doesn't seem like they work. But they do. Because traditionally, that's what we were. You think about the cities that were in Mexico and Central and South America by indigenous people, the Aztec and the Mayans, those were huge. And engineering that was accomplished there, huge. Astronomy, right? We have something called TEK, traditional ecological knowledge, which is basically the knowledge that we have from living on this land base for thousands of years and interacting with it and understanding the land and the connections and the weather patterns. So it's something that we have done since time immemorial. And so now, as we become contemporary, just like everybody else, we integrate that. So it is a natural fit for our people. And then finally, before we have a little bit of question and answer or discussion, I give all the, you know, I talk about this a lot, and people are like, so what do you want from us? So I think first and foremost, what what we hope and why I try to talk to groups and we try to have these conversations in the position that I'm in, the American Indian Science and Engineering Society, right, to increase STEM. We have conferences like this. We have a career fair. We have Intel and Boeing and Microsoft and all these employers. Try to talk to them like, you need to understand the history, because that makes you, then you understand who we are and how we got here and who we are today. And really, that's what I ask of every US citizen. You are on native land. You have an obligation to learn the history. And what you're given in school is not right, right? But we've covered it up and we've kind of glossed it over. And that doesn't mean that we're not patriotic. We are. And by the way, Native Americans serve in the highest proportion in the armed forces of any group. So we are patriotic. We love this land too. But we want to be acknowledged for our contributions and what, and really like what we gave up and how we can still be a part of society today. But often, like I said, we are just left out. We're 2% of the population. I talk to employers, they're like, and if anybody was at the panel yesterday, they're like, oh, yeah, well, we go to the National Society of Black Engineers and the Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers to hire because we can fill our diversity quota much faster. You guys are too small. You don't count. That doesn't help us. I'm like, really? So you tout diversity and inclusion. And as I said yesterday, you leave out the first Americans, the very land that you stand on. So this is where what Native people, when you see them and they say and they point to the stereotypes and the imagery and they're upset, it's so much bigger than just that mascot symbol, right? It's all of this that we just talked about or that I just talked about. We want people to start to understand us. And then the acknowledgement that we're contemporary people. A lot of times the mascots, right, are all, it's a caricature, first of all, but it's also, you know, in the past.
I've always been good.
Oh, that's the next video. Okay, so then, so this commitment from corporation and government agencies and workforce development that we matter and that they're interested in talking to us and to including us because we are part of this. So, you can roll the video if you want, and then we'll do question and answer. It's 30 seconds long. It's very short. Oh, now did they lose it?
I've always been good with numbers, and I like to build things. My grandparents used to tell me that if I put my mind to it, I can make the world a better place. Thanks to the support through AISES, I am currently studying biology at UNM. Once I graduate, I plan to work in the medical field, building life-saving devices. I guess it's my way of giving back.
American Indian Science and Engineering Society, investing in STEM education for Native students. Find out more at aises.org.
I've always been good.
Oh, I'm going to watch it again. Thank you. So, and thank you to Comcast NBC Universal, who sees the value and what we're doing and actually gave us $1.8 million in pro bono airtime last year and again this year to be running those PSAs, so you might see them on TV. But again, to just try to educate people about Native Americans are here. So with that, if you're interested in our organization in particular, it's very easy, aises.org. You don't have to be Native to join or be involved or come to the conference or any of our events. We're looking for anybody who wants to be supportive of what we're trying to do and really just want to, and we're happy with questions and people who want to come learn. The one thing that I would say is spectacular about our events that sets it aside from others is the cultural piece. And I didn't touch a lot on that, but it is important. And as you kind of saw in the leadership video, there were some components of that. And we welcome everybody. So with that, I'm going to end. And if anybody has any questions or comments, be happy to take those. Or if not, then we can be done. So thank you. I'm going to get some water. Anybody? Did I scare everybody? I think there's mics, yeah.
Hi. I think that was an excellent presentation, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
So my quick question is, you made a comment at the beginning of the presentation, and I understood your example. You said that, you know, Arizona wouldn't give money to, I think you were saying, Chicago, maybe I'm wrong, or Illinois. But I think in this day and age, why not at this point? If, as you pointed out in your example, that the First Nations, the Native Americans were brought together,
right,
and they started to collaborate. I think if there's only 2% of the Native Americans left, I think they should be encouraged to collaborate, even the ones that have, as you pointed out, the money. Is that being looked at?
Yes, it is, and it does happen. But it's, so like when we, one point, and this has been several years, like when we broke down the total casino revenue from Native casinos and broke it down by Native, like how many Native people there were, it was about $8 a person, so annually. So it's not enough, right? And so certainly have that, like even at our organization, we have tribal sponsors. And so that does happen, but it's not enough to solve the issues, if you will. And this idea of Native people working together is a concept that came up in the 1900s, because we really did identify, and still do, but definitely prior to that, as our individual tribes. But yes, it is happening. And there are all the different organizations, like the National Congress of American Indians, which is kind of like the UN, but it's for tribes, and other organizations that are doing that. Did that answer your question? I can't see you. Okay, it's bright up here. Sure.
Hi, once again, thank you for coming. This was awesome. And apologies, I'm probably going to be a bit rambling in my question, because I'm learning that this conference is really great at just sending a lot of thoughts racing through your brain at the speed of light.
Good.
So I think something that is coming out with the talk about women in computing and STEM is the nature versus nurture, and the culture that happens as we raise women, and what it is to be feminine, and all these things that are sort of driving women away from more STEM fields because it's not girly and all of that.
Right.
And so that kind of came to my forefront of my head when you were talking about the matrilineal nations and even some of the symbols of the circle of the religion and all of that. And so my question is, are there things that remain from Native culture that maybe could help us redefine what feminine culture is in the U.S.? I'm sure some of it was lost in the periods of time that you were talking about, but I'm wondering if maybe we can look to you to help us figure out to deal with our problems.
No, absolutely. And there are actually a lot of, not a lot, but there are publications out there. In fact, one was authored by my former boss who was at the university I taught at, called From Buckskin to Calico. But it's about Native American feminism and how that differs from feminism in contemporary U.S. And how, and again, like you said, like what are the differences and how can we learn? Because it is still more of a communal idea rather than an individualistic idea, if you will. So I can't really explain all that right now, but absolutely, absolutely, I think that there are a lot of lessons to be learned. And even, so yes, for feminism and for women, but also just for our society as a whole. I mean, and I didn't talk about Standing Rock, I'm sure a lot of you have heard about that, but the issues there, and the fact of this TEK, this traditional ecological knowledge, and these models that had subsisted us for, generations. There is much to be learned there, and we are happy to share that. We're just usually not asked, right? And we do, we have petroleum engineers, right? We have astronomers, we have an astronaut, a Chickasaw astronaut. He's on our board of directors, he's amazing. So there is a way to marry those, and there are lessons to be learned. So, if you want, I'd love to give you my card. I'd love to hook you up with some resources. That would be great.
Definitely. Thank you.
Yes. I'm like, the humidity here, I just can't.
Hi. I love the talk as well. Do you have anything through AIDS for STEM with girls? I live in Minneapolis, so I'm interested in helping with starting girls in science and engineering. And I know there are First Nations a lot. And so I'm just wondering, how would you start helping?
Okay, so did you say for girls?
Yeah.
Yes.
Or actually, I don't care.
Yeah, girls and volunteers, and boys, right? So you definitely have volunteer opportunities abundantly. I didn't go into a lot about AISES. We have 190 college chapters, 15 professional chapters, and about 158 middle school, high school affiliates. That's about 55,000 Native students. So on our website, you can find a lot of information, but you can actually access directories to all of those, or even just contact our office, and chances are we have something close to where you are if you're in the U.S., that we could get you involved. We also, of course, need volunteers at our conference and our events. And then to the women and girls, well, I say women and girls specifically, we're actually working on a program right now and talking with a number of foundations and with an organization called the Population Council in New York City, if anybody's heard of them. Can look them up because they do a lot of work with indigenous women, and now they're starting to do it here in the U.S. So we plan on rolling out a very large initiative, and specifically to target girls who are typically left out. So we have amazing students, you know, you saw them in these pictures and that are there, but what we've learned is that typically, generally, for the most part, who gets access to those opportunities or takes advantage of those opportunities are the girls, even within our communities, that have a little bit, what I would say, have are a little bit more fortunate, I guess, for lack of a better term. And that girls who often maybe on reservations who have been kept out of school or are in the state system, right, they don't get opportunities. And so how do we target those girls and give them these opportunities? And that's really the specific focus. We'll do more than that, but that's one of the specific focuses of these programs. And from that, what we need are mentors to help us with those projects. And so we'll be setting those up some pilot sites across the nation. And we hope that will be in 2018. But certainly I encourage anybody to come to the website. And there's a way to like stay connected. So of course we're on all the social media, but you can also just sign up to get notifications from us about our programming and events and all of that. And always just call the office to contact us. We'd love to have you. Yeah.
Hi, you just answered my question. I was going to ask about mentorship and yes. mentoring opportunities for some of these women. But I had some comments. So actually, when I was a freshman in college, there were two Native American students in my incoming class. It was really funny because one of them thought I was the other one. I am Mexican American, and he was like, you know, I just can't tell all the time. I have to ask you. It was funny. But and the other thing is the domestic violence numbers are very unfortunate, yeah. and I know they don't just occur, and they're occurring all over the place.
Right.
And yeah. And just a side comment, it just makes me think about, we're talking a lot about how we raise, or it was mentioned how we raise women, but it also made me think is like, we're also responsible for how we raise our boys.
Yes.
And yes. maybe that would be something we can do to help change those numbers.
Yeah. And certainly I think, you know, for us, sorry, were you finished?
That's
okay.
It.
I was going to say, I think, you know, for us, and I can't speak to all communities, but for the Native community, a lot of that has to do with those traditional roles and the traditional culture and tradition being stripped from us and, you know, supplanted with this other, you know, these other roles and the other way to do things and a lot of confusion. I mean, you can't take, the idea was you could take like an Indian child at 5 and by the time they turn 18, by, you know, cutting their hair and all this, then they will just become a non-Native person. Right, but then they send them home, and you've basically raised generations of children with no family, subject to abuse, lost their culture, and then you send them back to the reservation and expect them to be healthy and functioning and raise families and, you know, have a functioning society. It's not possible, right? There are going to be side effects. So a lot of the work that's being done with men and boys in Native communities is around culture camps and reintroducing tradition and the traditional roles of men and women and helping them understand that. So does that help answer? Okay. And yeah, and we certainly support that as well. And I didn't mention we have a council of elders at our organization, which is traditional tribal elders, who guide the board of directors, the staff in our work, but also are available for students and professionals who are interested. Because a lot of times, people have been cut off from their culture and their traditions, and they don't even know. And so they want that connection, and so we offer that as well. Yeah.
Thank you for being here today. One of the more recent exploding data sets that I've been really interested in and learning more about is the DNA testing that's been happening, right? Like it's $99, you can get your DNA tested. And to build on the Mexican-American person in the room, mm-hmm. I'm also of Hispanic descent, Latino America. But when you get that test, it just says North American Native, right, as the entire
right.
area. And so my question to you is maybe because you might have more insight into what's being, any conversations or any ideas, are there any things happening at a tribal level to sort of expand that base of knowledge on the DNA to help people understand more where we come from and how we can use that to unite each other instead of maybe building more barriers between each other. It's to me, it's a fascinating data set, but it's too broad.
Right.
I don't know if it's part of the history that maybe there's not enough people to localize anymore, but I'd be really interested in helping the Native American community get more tests so that they could understand more about what happened in that period of time frame that we now have just a lot of probably tribal knowledge on. I don't know.
Okay. That is a very loaded subject. I'm like, how do I approach this? And I certainly don't speak for all Indians. Let me see, how do I say this? Okay, so I'm not trying to offend anybody. So first I'll say about AISES, like we don't ask for tribal enrollment or citizenship and all of that. We do believe that tribes should be able to make that determination, but it's very controversial about who is Indian. I didn't get into it much, but who is Indian? You know, you mentioned, and I'm Chicana, right? Well, most likely you have Native heritage, you know, but it's been wiped away. So does that mean you're not Native? Or does that mean you are Native? Depends, like the federal government has a very strict viewpoint on that, right? AISES, we have a very broad viewpoint. And then there are people who maybe are part of a tribe, like they have their ID card, you know, I'm a citizen of whatever tribe, but they've lived in an urban setting, they've never connected with their community, they've never acknowledged that, they, you know, for all intents and purposes have assimilated. Are those people Native? Well, they have the card, but they're not really. So I used to struggle with this when I would teach. I don't think there is a clear answer. So I'm sorry to tell you that. In terms of the DNA piece, I think that's interesting. I love the commercial where the woman's like, I found out I'm Native, and now I have, what is it, like pottery or something? Yeah. Now I have pottery. I'm like, yeah, okay. But often that's how people kind of see us, right? Instead of, and so I kind of like, and it is funny, right? And as Native people, we're kind of like, I wonder what my DNA would say. And then I'd be like, I'm going to show up in Germany and be like, yo, I'm here. So, and now I want to know about your Germanic culture so I can rediscover my roots. No, so, and I am German and English, by the way, and Native. So it's a loaded question. I do think DNA is interesting. I think what we're seeing about tribal nations, to your point, is that as tribal people, as Native people, we are becoming more inclusive. A lot of that has been, why it's been closed is it's out of fear. Because so much is always taken from us, and even people coming with like good intentions, the Friends of the Indians group that was like in the 1900s who believed that they had to Christianize Indians, like that was in the best interest. So we're very kind of gun shy, right, about anybody coming in and saying, you know, we want to be part of it, or we want to join, or be some, you know, included. But I think a lot of that is changing, and part of that is because of that blood quantum and the way that we've been defined, and a lot of tribal membership is defined, we're gonna marry or reproduce out of existence. I said my dad was full. I'm sorry, my grandfather was full, my dad was half, so I'm technically a quarter. My children, I married a non-Native, are an eighth, right? But if the tribe holds that one quarter blood quantum, then my children, they lowered it to an eighth, by the way, but they wouldn't be enrolled. They wouldn't be able to be recognized as Native people. And if we continue down that path, we're going to lose it all. And so I think there is a big debate going on, and tribes have the ability to, and some have, to have citizenship with a lot, you know, defined differently than through that blood quantum. And so I think the DNA is interesting. Right now it is very broad, and I honestly don't know much about it. I don't even know how accurate it is. We did, when I worked for the American Indian College Fund, which raises support for tribal colleges and universities, we would have people call us on the phone and say, like, oh, I found out that I'm a descendant of, you know, some tribe, and where's my Indian money? You know, because again, that kind of the misperception. And then, so anyway, my point is that there's a long way to go there, but I think that it's becoming more open, and I think it has to be, because if we're gonna exist as Native people, again, we're gonna have to do that, and we're gonna have to be more open about that. And if you think about it, if we don't, we're playing into the hand of, and I'm not trying to demonize the federal government, I'm a political science major, I went to law school, but that we're playing into that colonization mindset, right? Of limiting ourselves just by that definition. So if we allow ourselves to reproduce because we hold that strict, hold on to that strict guideline, that strict idea, then we're going to be gone. You know, and so I think we do need to open up, and maybe it will be through DNA as it gets more and more precise, if you will. And typically, if you visit a reservation, as long as you are, you know, humble and, you know, not just trying to ask a lot of questions, you're just a decent person, and you go, like, you will be welcomed. It's not as scary as I think a lot of people, you know, kind of perceive. You would be welcome there. So anyway, I know I'm out of time, so I need to end. But I just want to thank you all for coming, and I will be out in a minute. I'll go out front, and I'd love to talk to anybody who has any other questions, and I have business cards, and I'll leave it at that. So thank you.